To begin, I'll just go over a brief introduction, kind of get you oriented on our webinar, who we have coming up, what the process is. I'll start by presenting the findings of our research report, followed by my colleague, Shireen Mavandad, who will continue the second part. Then I'll introduce our panel of four experts. And finally, I'll open up to the audience so that you can ask your important question. For the questions, please feel free to use the chat. If you'd like, you know, do so at any time, but especially during the Q&A, and we'll read off the questions to the panel and make sure that you get yours answered. Great. As I mentioned, I'm the I work for CLASP, which is a nonprofit NGO that improves the energy and environmental performance of the appliances and equipment that we use every day, accelerating our transition to a more sustainable world. And we do this through working on grid, so where efficient appliances reduce energy consumption and associated pollution and CO2 emissions, thereby helping with climate mitigation, as well as off-grid, where super efficient appliances allow one to decrease the size and thereby the cost of solar panels, providing energy access to more people, or the same solar panel can provide more energy services. So not just lighting, but productive use appliances like refrigeration, solar water pumps, thereby improving quality of life. And today we'll be talking about ways of accelerating on-grid efficiency by examining the efficiency standards for six key appliances across top 10 economies. You can download the report by scanning the QR code here, as well as I'll ask one of my colleagues here to also put in the chat if that's easier. Here's the link as well. So my colleagues and I at CLASP, along with some international experts, examined efficiency levels that have been achieved today across these 10 top emitting economies. We compared those to global benchmarks, such as the United for Efficiency's model regulations, as well as countries' own internal goals. So goals of achieving net zero energy or electrifying fossil heating, space and water heating, to see how well our countries approaching their own goals. Again, the goal is to learn from each other and to drive ambition around the world. And so looking forward to achieving that today. Before I get into the findings, I just wanted to briefly touch on some of the important points of our research as they relate to having a fair comparison between countries. First of all, not all economies can reach the same levels, right? Due to issues with climate, product availability, you know, you may not be able to set policies at the same levels because the products just cannot perform that are in a given economy. Lastly, the economics or the costs. In many countries, governments are constrained from imposing standards that do not pay back. So the user, you know, is expected to pay a little bit more upfront, but make up that money through lower energy costs. Of course, energy costs and prices vary from country to country, so the results will be different. And so nothing here is intended to say that countries need to adopt the same MEPS at the same moment. There are other policies and programs such as voluntary labeling, market development that can allow countries to promote those levels even if they cannot incorporate them into their MEPS. And lastly, some of these products are just not comparable between countries. And by that, let me illustrate that here with water heaters. This is the result of an IEA 4E mapping and benchmarking exercise from 2017, which looks at the capacity and performance of electric storage water heaters. In blue, you can see the water heaters in China, which if you look at the horizontal or x-axis are all below about 100 liters. In the United States, by contrast, they are greater than 100 liters. And so, you know, how do you compare the MEPS when there isn't that much of an overlap? Well, we used representative units that try to bridge that gap by finding a unit that's you know, somewhere in the middle globally, evaluating the MEPS for that unit, making the comparison, even though there will be larger and smaller units and the MEPS may be higher or lower for those units in given countries. So here's an example of our first example with refrigerators. We used a 400 liter frost-free refrigerator freezer as a representative unit. It was assumed to have a 300 liter fresh food compartment and a 100 liter top-mounted freezer compartment. And we used the annual energy consumption metric. So if the country had something like an index, energy efficiency index, we would convert it to an annual energy consumption. Finally, we try to correct for climate and the tests that different countries conducted by normalizing the performance from 32 degrees Celsius, as some countries test, down to 24 degrees Celsius. At that lower temperature, the compartments present lower heat load. The compressor has a higher coefficient of performance, or COP. Here's what that looks like in terms of energy from an analysis done in support of IEC standard development. On the upper right of the graph would be the performance at 32 degrees for a typical refrigerator freezer. And then here in the middle is where what the energy consumption is like for at 24 degrees C. So we had to adjust the MEPS to account for that. So we started first with, say, a MEPS at 32 degrees Celsius. We would scale that MEPS down to 24 degrees using the relationships you just saw. Sometimes the adjusted volume would also have to be scaled because the relative contribution of the freezer and the fresh food compartment vary at lower temperatures. And so in the end, we would have, again, what would be the MEPS requirement for that 400 liter refrigerator freezer if that country tested at a lower temperature. So that was about half the countries. So here are the results. The yellow dashed line at 279 kilowatt hours per year is the United for Efficiency model regulation level for refrigerators at this size. And as you can see, the good news is many of the economies already surpassed this, right? And one is quite close. So, you know, to us, this seems like an achievable target. And we hope that more economies adopt it. And those that have already gone that far, that they reduce their level down to 223 kilowatt hours per year, which is the next euphoria level, the intermediate target. And again, you can find more information about this, the performance and the methodology in the report. Next, I'll talk about residential water heating. So here our product is gas storage and instantaneous water heaters, as well as electric storage water heaters. You'll see there are no electric instantaneous. One reason is those are already quite efficient. There isn't too much more that can be done with that specific product type. We've also left out solar, which, you know, is quite popular around the world, but in some countries around the world, but you know, it's not always practical to convert from a fossil fuel heater to solar. And so we looked at opportunities that are, you know, don't require a fuel switch, which again, some of the agencies instituting MEPS may be prevented from doing. Moreover, you know, when IEA looked at this a couple of years ago, they really saw that the biggest changes came from these kinds of larger shifts. So going from non-condensing to condensing technology, from electric resistance storage to heat pumps, that's where you could get the most savings. And so, you know, rather than looking at individual percentages, we looked at some of these larger technology shifts within the different fuel types. So for instance, in the United States, water heaters above 55 gallons, which is around 200 liters, electric storage water heaters are required to use heat pump efficiency levels. And so those represent around 20% of the market. And so here we see the US ranked, you know, graded highly, you know, up at 20%, because 20% of the market or the stock of water heaters is now required to reach those efficiency levels, heat pump efficiency levels. Something similar is in the EU, where larger water, electric storage water heaters also are required to reach heat pump efficiency levels. However, the proportion of those larger heaters is smaller in the EU, and hence the EU's lower score there. And that's again, the case for the UK, which has the same regulations currently as the EU, but the share of those larger water heaters is even smaller. In Canada, the approach has been slightly different. There, the focus has been on condensing efficiency levels for instantaneous gas, but those similarly make up a smaller share of the market, and so a smaller percentage. So again, you know, to raise the score, we encourage countries to focus on condensing and heat pumps. In residential space heating, we conducted a very similar analysis. This time looking at gas furnaces and boilers, electric resistance heating, and now have also added one-way air conditioners, which could be converted to heat pumps to provide heating. And that's the case in Japan. Here's some market data from Japan. If you could look at the lower two graphs, which represent the majority of the market in the warmer regions of the country, the majority of the heating is conducted with air conditioners. You know, so how can that be? Well, they're not just one-way air conditioners, as you perhaps may be used to. They're reversible two-way air conditioners, also known as air-to-air heat pumps or mini-split heat pumps. And so, you know, more than 70% of the sales are actually of those units. So not gas heating, not oil heating, but air conditioners working as heat pump and providing the heating there. And that's also the case in China, where, you know, more than 40% of homes are heated, or more than 40% of the heating stock is heat pumps or air conditioners that are, they're reversible. In Canada, again, the contrasting approach is to focus on condensing for gas at the current moment. So similar to water heating, recommendation would be to require MEPS that require condensing efficiencies, heat pumps, and finally replacing one-way air conditioners in climates with heating with two-way heat pumps. And that's, you know, it, we can see that already in some of the roadmaps that countries are adopting. This is a Canadian Energy and Mine Ministers Conference roadmap, where we have 90% condensing in the short term and more than 100% efficiency, so heat pumps in the longer term. And now I'd like to hand it over to my colleague Shireen Mavandad for a continuation. Shireen, over to you.
Thanks, Matt. All righty. So I'll be going over the last three products that we did in our study. So starting off with lighting, we looked specifically at residential indoor non-directional general service lamps, and we standardized the product to be that of a luminous flux of 800 lumens and a color rendering index of 80. And the metric we used to compare MEPS across all economies was luminous efficacy and lumens per watt. And another key thing in our analysis is that we only ranked economies with technology neutral MEPS. And this means that they only have one policy that pertains to all types of lighting instead of separate policies for LEDs, CFLs, and incandescents. So here's an example of one of the policies we looked at. This is for Canada's lighting policy. And just to outline how we standardized the product, we looked at which product category fell into our 800 lumen and 80 CRI category, which is in row two, And then to calculate luminous efficacy, we just divided the lumens, 800, by the nominal power that was provided, 43, to get a luminous efficacy of 18. So that's just the process that we went through to do the calculation. And what we defined as the target for ambitious lighting MEPS was 90 lumens per watt. And the reason we picked this number is that it ensures that inefficient lighting products like CFLs and incandescent bulbs are phased out completely out of the market. And it's also still in line with U4E's model regulation, which suggests a MEPS requirement of at least 80 lumens per watt. That 90 lumens also just ensures a higher quality of LEDs is on the market. And our results show that out of the 10 economies we assessed, the EU and UK are the two that have successfully phased out CFLs and incandescent lamps through that 90 lumen per watt target and net technology neutral policies. And just to show the importance of why we're emphasizing technology neutral policies, this is what the comparison chart would look like if we only looked at economies LED specific policies. So as you can see, it appears that Indonesia and India are pretty close to meeting the target. They come within 25% of that 90 lumen per watt criteria. However, it's an inaccurate representation of the actual market there, because CFLs and incandescent lamps are continuing to being sold in those economies and make up a significant portion of the market, and thereby resulting the lighting energy consumption in both countries to be pretty high. So it's basically just showing that having technology neutral policies is the best way to ensure that you're maximizing the environmental benefits with your lighting policies. And with that, our recommendations are that all economies should adopt a technology neutral MEPS at 90 lumens per watt or greater. And we want to greatly emphasize this recommendation, as the widespread deployment of LEDs in all economies by 2025 is essential to achieving the net zero emissions goal by 2050. And economies that already meet this requirement, like the EU and UK, we recommend that they strive for even more ambitious MEPS set to at least 120 lumens per watt. And those that will be adopting 90 lumens per watt in the future can set that 120 standard as their second tier, with a compliance date a little further in the future. And this will just ensure that the regulation will keep pace with the ongoing technological improvements of LED lighting. Moving up, next we looked at electric motors. For motors, we looked specifically at three-phase alternating current induction motors with a voltage less than 1,000. The metric we used to compare MEPS across all economies was the efficiency class used under IEC 60034, as well as if additional MEPS for motor-driven applications like fans, pumps, or air compressors were included in the economies policy. And I'll explain this a little further. So the first metric is the IE class range, which they range from IE1 to IE5, and economies received a score based on that level. So for example, if an economy is using the IE2 standard, they'll receive a score of 2, IE3, they get a score of 3. And as you can see, many of the economies we looked at are split between IE2 and IE3. This map shows that the EU and UK are the only two economies that have some motors that fall under the IE4 class, which are the first economies to set a standard at that level. But when you take a closer look at their policy, it actually splits motors in that less than 1000 volt range between IE2, IE3, and IE4. So not all motors are gonna be using that IE4 standard. And in actuality, motors within the 0.75 to 1000 kilowatt range, which make up the majority of energy consumption in those economies, fall under the IE3 class. So that is the score that the EU and UK received, is a score of 3 for this, not a 4, just because that's where the majority of the motors in our standardized size fall. And the second part of our scoring, as I mentioned, is based on the addition of motor-driven applications. So that includes things like fans, pumps, air compressors, and converters. And if MEPS for these things are also included under the motor MEPS, they received an additional half point to their score. So this means the maximum attainable score possible in our analysis was a 5.5. However, we set the target for ambitious electric motor MEPS at any score that's greater than 3. And this score aligns with U4E's model recommendation of using the IE3 efficiency standard, which is why we picked it. And our results showed that Canada, China, the EU, UK, and US are all leaders in electric motor MEPS, and Brazil and Japan are not that far behind. And when they meet that IE3 level, they just don't include additional parameters. And so the reason the leaders are above that 3 level is because they had at least one of the additional components included in their motor MEPS. Moving on to recommendations, we recommend that all economies should align their motor MEPS with U4E's model regulation and require at least a minimum efficiency level of IE3. And the economies that already meet that target should strive for reaching IE4 or IE5. In addition to that, economies who don't already have additional motor components included into their MEPS requirements, they should plan on including them. That's a great way to maximize efficiency and have more environmental benefits with the policy. Last up, I'm going to be talking about air conditioners. So for ACs, we looked at split systems and we standardized it for a 7 kW cooling capacity. And the metric we used to compare MEPS across all economies was the ISO CSPF watt hour per watt hour seasonal energy efficiency metric. And just to note that if an economy did not use a seasonal energy efficiency metric, meaning that they still use EER as their unit, they were not ranked in our analysis, as it indicates that their policy is outdated. Different economies have different seasonal energy efficiency metrics, and in order to convert them all into the ISO CSPF watt hour per watt hour, we use the methodology outlined in the 2020 paper Lost in Translation by Juan Park. This was a really helpful paper. In this top row over here, you can see that the economies that we looked at all had this nice equation laid out to make the conversion pretty simple and straightforward. And these were the results that were shown in our paper. And actually, recently, it was brought to our attention that the MEPS that we found for China was actually using the wrong size of unit. So this reflects a 4.5 kilowatt units MEPS, not the 7 kW standardized. So this information is actually incorrect, and we worked to update it, and it will be updated in the report very soon. But these are the accurate results for air conditioners. And so what we defined as a target for ambitious AC MEPS at or above the cooling seasonal performance metric of 5.1 watt hours per watt hours, and this target is aligned with the current minimum standard in U4E's model regulation. And our analysis found that China's AC MEPS level for cooling only products meets this U4E model regulation target, and Japan's top runner requirement isn't that far behind. And Brazil, the EU, UK, and US are also within 25% of this target. You'll notice that there are 2 scores included for China. One is for cooling only units, which are predominantly exported to other economies. And one is for reversible heat pumps, which Matt mentioned earlier in his presentation, which comprise 97% of the room air conditioner market of China. Which is why we included both, just because one is internal and one is external. We thought both were important to include. And it should also be noted that China has separate MEPS for fixed and variable speed cooling units. The numbers for both of China's requirements in this graph are reflective of the variable speed units, as those dominate their market. But once again, both of these things just kind of call out the need for technology neutral policies, as all types of cooling units should be held to the same efficiency standard to maximize environmental benefits. Moving on to the recommendations, we recommend that at a minimum, all economies should align their standard with U4E's guideline and adopt technology neutral MEPS of 5.1 watt hour per watt hour or greater. And the reason we think that this is a feasible goal is that China produces over 70 to 80% of the room air conditioners sold around the world. So this means that the technology and supply chain exists to make this a feasible standard, since their products already meet this standard. Additionally, we recommend that any economy using the energy efficiency ratio still should switch to a seasonal performance metric for both fixed and variable speed ACs. And that wraps up our results from our paper. Matt, I'll hand it back off to you if you want to introduce our panel.
Thank you so much, Shireen, and welcome to our panel. First, I'd like to introduce Clara Camarasa, who is an energy efficiency policy analyst at the International Energy Agency, or IEA. As a buildings and appliance expert, her work involves data analysis, capacity building, and policy advice for emerging economies in their transition toward net zero carbon, focusing on the building sector. Prior to joining the IEA, Clara worked at the UN Environment Program Copenhagen Climate Center in Denmark, focusing on the development of analytical frameworks and tools to ensure the decarbonization of the built environment. Welcome, Clara. Next, I'd like to introduce Theo Covery, who has over 15 years of experience in appliance efficiency. A focus of his work has been the resulting impacts and benefits for the public and private sectors. He's regularly contracted by international agencies and has supported, developed, and implemented several government programs in South Africa, as well as other African countries. Welcome, Theo.
Thank you.
Next, Rob Singlehurst is a manager in the Office of Energy Efficiency at Natural Resources Canada. His team is responsible for residential product standards development in support of Canada's energy efficiency regulations. He is a professional engineer with a European Master in Renewable Energy, a LEED accredited professional, and a certified sustainable building advisor. Welcome, Rob. And finally, Martin van Verkoven is an independent energy business consultant with TPA Advisors based in the Netherlands, with a special focus on energy efficiency and energy transition in industry. He is active as operating agent of the Electric Motor Systems Annex, part of the IEA Technology Cooperation Program, or E, and is a member of the IEC Advisory Committee on Energy Efficiency, as a member of the ISO-IEC Joint Advisory Group 22. Welcome, Martin. And Theo and Rob, we can't see you yet. So if you wouldn't mind turning on your video so everybody can get to know you here. And I'll begin with maybe a couple questions for the panel. The first one would be, oh, perfect. Thank you so much. What potential challenges do you foresee in advancing MEPS in the countries you have expertise on or have worked in? And what tools can policymakers there use to overcome those challenges? So maybe let's kick it off with Theo, please.
Thank you, Matt. And apologies for the visual. We've got load shedding at the moment. We've got power outages, and I got caught with the wrong time schedule. So I had to run into another room where we've got power, and I don't have a backlight, and it's getting dark here. So apologies for that. What I would say in response to this is that political will is what I have found, and political understanding of the potential of MEPS is a huge issue. I would imagine it is so around the world, but specifically in the regions where I've worked around Africa, people are obsessed with supply-driven solutions to energy access, and rather increasing energy supply to reduce the price of electricity and energy poverty, as opposed to energy efficiency. And I really have experienced that senior people lack the imagination and the understanding of what can be achieved. So that is what I see as a huge barrier, and I'll add in as we go through the conversation a little bit more. Thank you.
How about Rob next?
Yeah, certainly. Thank you, Matt. Natural Resources Canada has provided the authority to regulate energy using products under our Efficiency Act. One challenge that we face is really just the sheer market weight of our neighbors to the south, including Mexico. Canada's just about 8% of the North American market. So to develop unique regulations is not only an uphill battle in terms of our work as policymakers, but it can lead, of course, to testing and administrative burden, and potentially reduced availability and choice of products, and increased costs for end users. Now, for many products with global markets and for which Canada has limited manufacturing capability, and I'm really speaking about lighting, electronics, and major appliances, we recognize that alignment of regulations with the US is the least burdensome and most practical approach. And we're fortunate right now that the US is now rapidly advancing improvements to its minimum performance requirements for many products. And this move by this heavyweight will lead to sort of trickle down improvements irrespective of regulatory action. Now, regarding regulatory tools, recent changes to our Energy Efficiency Act now provides our Minister of Natural Resources with the authority to sign into law amendments to the regulations. Now, this is for the purpose of maintaining alignment, not for new products. But the normal product process is you know, certainly much more bureaucratic, as it must go to the parliamentary cabinet for approval. So this tool of ministerial regulations has the potential to really streamline the regulatory process and to eliminate or even to minimize or eliminate the time of misalignment. Natural Resources is making increased use of incorporation by reference, not only to other jurisdictions' regulations directly, but of a new tool, technical standards documents. This is a new instrument that we're piloting, such that the regulations reference this technical support document that can be modified outside of a regulatory or government cycle. But of course, with full stakeholder engagement and consultation. So this will allow us as regulators to be more nimble. Thanks.
Great. Thank you, Rob. So we've heard about political will, and then, in some cases, even when the political will exists, you know, there are larger neighbors, there are regulatory burdens that may need to be overcome. Martin, how about yourself? What challenges have you seen and what tools exist?
Well, as for my contribution on the first question, I'm focusing on motors, electric motors and motor systems, so including also the pumps, the fans, the compressors. Firstly, talking from a European perspective, where for a number of years, MEPS are in place for these products. The first and important product are the motors themselves. And for these, the benefit is that there's a global standard available, a standard which defines the testing method and also the classification, efficiency classification of the product. And the first, I think, MEPS goes back about 10 years. And what you now see is that in a revision cycle, the EU has decided to increase the stringency, as elaborated by Shirin, but also the scope, so meaning that the scope is widened towards other products, other type of motors. The size, the larger motors and the smaller motors. And the second one is the step from product only to the unit. So including not only the pump itself, but the motor, the VSD and the pump in one metric and in one MEPS. So this is a sort of cycle which every MEPS, I think, in the world has, a revision cycle of 5 years. And I think the good news is for the EU that with this step, which has had some delayment, but still brings further energy savings for the EU, but also for other countries which do not have yet MEPS in place. They can take, for instance, the EU MEPS as an example, but also, for instance, the MEPS for motors in the US or in China, where these countries can profit of the experiences gained within these regions. And of course, every MEPS has a main set of elements, being market knowledge. How does the market look like in a specific country? But then the backbone of the MEPS being the standards, the availability of global applicable standards, and then, of course, a mechanism for monitoring, verification, and enforcement. And each country has to decide themselves upon which one to choose. But there we have, for instance, the information set from the U4E, which defines a guide for governments and other NGOs working on MEPS, and also some model regulations as a start.
Thank you so much, Martin. So not just the MEPS, but also the rest of the regulatory framework is important.
Sure.
And perfect. Clara, how about yourself? What have you seen as either a challenge or a potential solution?
Okay. Well, I'm going to, thanks, Matt. I'll share my experience from the Latin America region, because I think other regions have been very nicely covered by the other panelists. So what we see, we're now in the process of what we call the Latin America seat pathway, which is trying to, within the call to action that you mentioned in the introduction presentation, trying to make sure that we support countries in the region to achieve this doubling of efficiency of sold products for four particular products. These are refrigerators, fans, ACs, and electric motor systems. And within that, and based on a very long, let's say, process, In discussing with a number of countries in Latin America, one of the key findings and common challenges pointed out by the policymakers and other stakeholders involved in the process when it comes to advancing MEPS for these selected products would be the lack of market data to explain both the benefits of more efficient products, but also to understand the viability of these more efficient products. For instance, the effect of these policy instruments such as the MEPS and labels in order to reach this. When we talk about particularly regional harmonization, one of the key challenges would be the lack of sustainable business models to ensure long-lasting test lab facilities, for instance, and this would include mutual recognition agreements that would allow this to take place, as well as other enabling policy framework or regulation. For instance, some countries argue that they would not have test labs outside the region due to the regulation, and therefore regional harmonization might be challenging. As part of the second question, the tools that policymakers can use to overcome these challenges, I would highlight, first of all, the systematic market data collection to ensure an up-to-date understanding of MEPS and how are these being implemented in the market, making sure that these MEPS are also accompanied by labels, for instance, and making sure that these in effect are being implemented in the market, as market data allows, of course, an effective timely revision through solid market tracking. Another information we've seen very useful is, for instance, collecting information versus or about efficiency versus price, retail price. So making sure that the market understands what's really happening in terms of, for instance, if more efficient appliances have the same retail price and as less efficient appliances, and actually our data collection has consistently proved that that is not the case. So you can purchase in a market, in most markets that we've studied, if not all, the same for the same price, a more efficient appliance than not efficient appliances. So that's something that would be very helpful for governments to collect in order to support and consolidate and revise their own MEPS. Another important tools would be to set product specific goals, objectives, and pathways, which is very much related to what you, Matt, and Shirin were describing in the recommendations based on this report and study you've made. So really making sure that they do have that on a national level and even on a international level in case they're exporters of these products. Very importantly, I would say even a very crucial point is that all stakeholders should participate in the design, implementation, revision, and monitoring process. This is crucial, particularly in the case of a regional harmonization. So making sure that everybody's working towards the same direction that should be based on this product-specific goal that has been set previously. Alignment of test procedures for energy performance with international protocols, if not already existing, the creation of regional registration system for all products and appliances in the market, and making sure that MEPS is not the only policy instrument that is present in the market. I know today we're focusing mostly on MEPS, but it's important that this is maybe the most relevant one or the strongest one, but it should be accompanied by a policy package, including incentives, information instruments, et cetera, in order to raise awareness for consumers, for installers, and creating incentives for manufacturers and retailers. Within the IEA, we developed the energy efficiency policy package for appliances that I will share in the chat, which kind of condenses this understanding of making MEPS one of the most important tools, but then making sure that there's a bundle of other policy instruments that really strengthen the power of MEPS. And that would be it from my side. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Clara. Thank you. Thank you to the panelists. And hopefully, you know, the audience is able to get some interesting strategies. Oh, Theo, please. You wanted to follow up on that?
Yeah, thank you. What I would also say is that government needs to be a little bit bold or bolder. Often, how can I phrase this delicately? Often they're too accommodating to the private sector's requests. Now, I'm not suggesting that they should be destructive in the sense that impacting local manufacturing, but when there's a clear-cut case that there will be a net benefit to the economy, and it's proven through research, and there's one or two members in the private sector who are objecting to it for, let's call it, for profit motives. Often, it's my experience that government often rolls over, gives them the benefit of the doubt. We lose another year. Then they just keep kicking the can down the road. And I've got countless examples from South Africa where this is the case. And it's just not assisting. We've got 6 to 8 hours of outages a day, and I'm not suggesting that our MEPS would have stopped that, but they certainly would have helped if they were implemented when the program wanted these implemented, but wasn't for a variety of reasons. And if I can give you a speaking about water heaters, and we did a lot of work with the Lawrence Berkeley Lab and CLASP some years ago, so. Typically in South Africa, we have a 150-liter electric water heater, grossly inefficient. Their standing losses were around 2.5 kilowatt hours per day. We did some testing. It's all local manufacturing, as you can imagine, for these types of low technology, large units that you can't really import because it's easy to make. And we wanted to drop that to around 1.4 kilowatt hours, and the local industry fought us tooth and nail. And for some reason, someone in government decided to go ahead with it, and that was fine. Industry just adjusted, and it's our biggest contributor to electricity savings in the entire program. Whereas now, as Martin will say, we're trying to introduce. We've got no MEPS for electric motors, so we want to go straight to IE3 for the reasons he explained. There's an established value supply chain. These are accessible. 80% of the market wants it to go to IE3, and we've got one or two small companies objecting, and it's stalling us. The same thing general service lamps. These have been sitting on the minister's desk for 3 years because of a claim made by one of the European suppliers saying that Africa is not ready for this type of technology, and citing concerns around affordability and energy security, and which is nonsense. So, I think sometimes government needs to be bold and call the bluff, especially when they're backed by credible research. Thank you.
And for our next question, thank you so much, Theo, for that very insightful follow-up. Our next question for the panel is there any product category that you think a particular economy should prioritize when advancing their MEPS or enabling specific actions that will help improve the overall process? So to start off, Clara, do you want to kick us off?
Well, thanks for the question. Happy to kick off. Again, I think there's two elements to this question. I will start probably with the first part of what are the product categories that I think should be particularly prioritized in particular economies. I think it very much depends on the context. So I'm going to split it out in general terms, and then again, a focus on Latin America. So when it comes to general terms, focusing on appliance for space and cooling seems like a logical step. According to IEA estimates, almost half of the energy demand for buildings globally was used for space and water heating in 2021. And within the space heating and cooling technologies, heat pumps are increasingly recognized as a critical cornerstone technology for heat decarbonization. So it seems a product category that should be receiving increasing policy support and prioritization in many regions, particularly in Europe and the US. I also have to mention that in the call to action that has been mentioned several times now, we identified industrial motor systems, refrigerators, lighting as product categories that should be prioritized globally, as together these motor, air conditioners, refrigerators, and lightings account for approximately 40% of the global electricity consumption. So they're definitely very relevant products when it comes to the whole energy sector in demand. Now, thinking particularly on Latin America, and I know this is not particularly related to MEPS, but there are things that need to be prioritized that are critical to this region, which is, for instance, the transition to a clean cooking. So even with Latin America having a relatively use of polluting fuels for cooking in relation to other regions such as Africa and Southeast Asia, for Latin America, this is around 15%. And for both Africa and Southeast Asia, this is above 60%. It is true that Latin America has been a kind of a testing ground for policies and approaches towards a more clean cooking. And a range of different approaches and actions have been followed in different countries with very different results, because it's definitely a very heterogeneous region. But on items or in terms of policies that can support this transition and clean cooking that could complement MEPS, I would like to share the ban on non-clean cooking options such as firewood or charcoal, and in parallel developing procurement models and financing mechanisms to support the energy efficient clean cooking appliances for those segments with more issues of affordability. One example would be subsidies for electric cooking stoves, which have been very effective in the region. So once again, highlighting not only the importance of MEPS, but also the importance of creating a bundle of policy instruments that accompany MEPS in order to really make the right transition in the market. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Clara. Theo, how about yourself? So we talked a little bit about the call to action products, clean cooking. What are you seeing in the geographies where you work as the best opportunities?
Yeah, so I suppose just drawing from my experience and some insights on that, it's quite a different approach if you go for the sort of residential sector of ovens, laundry, water heaters, etc., And in the industrial sector, where you're going electric motors, chillers, and it's quite different competencies. And often, you know, these teams, certainly where I am, are these programs are possibly underfunded. You don't have the time to go between the two sectors. So it's quite important to be strategic about how you implement it and be able to broaden it. It could be perhaps two different units. In South Africa, we had UNIDO funding the National CLIDA Production Center, which was running industrial energy efficiency under the radar, very successful, huge savings, working with companies and all of that sort of thing. But that was voluntary without the MEPS. It would have been great if that program could have had the ability to introduce MEPS for some of these products. On the other side, where I've been more involved is on the residential sector. So once you start getting involved in the household, you know, the one follows the other. And then you need to start, you know, we started with the large ones, laundry, dishwashers, AC, water heaters, refrigeration. And then we did a study to identify the next set of appliances, and the brief to the consultants was, well, go and find the ones that will give us the biggest savings, which means they have a high penetration rate and a high usage rate. And that also there are other programs around the world that have implemented, so we can learn from them, that we don't have issues around importing those kind of products. So we don't want to break new ground, right? We just want to sort of align, because that'll give us a greater push. What's often overlooked is a review of your standards, because that's almost like introducing a new standard, right? We did ours in 2015. It's now 2022. They've far outlived their usefulness. So if we introduced standards to refrigerators, strengthened the MEPS, that would be almost like introducing new MEPS to another product. But we'd know we get bigger savings because of what refrigeration and the role it plays in people's lives. So yeah, those would be my thoughts. Thank you.
Thank you, Theo. Martin, you mentioned already motors, VSDs, pumps. Anything else for opportunities?
Well, yeah, I can only agree with the other speakers, like Theo, Clara. But with motor systems, some overall data from IEA shows a share of, in terms of electricity use worldwide, between 40% and 50% by electric-driven or electric motor-driven systems. So it makes very good sense to, to start there, but to include them into your policies. And of course, then, depending on the countries, you can make other supporting choices for other products, like the chillers, the cooling units, the ventilation units. So it becomes more a larger selection of products. But also depending on the type of regulation you choose to implement, it's a bit different picture. For instance, what I'm referring to is, like within the EU, the type of regulation they have, there all motors which are placed on the market are falling under these MEPS. So that includes also embedded motors, they're called, being motors included in other products, they also are regulated. So in one MEPS, you directly grasp a large portion of the market. So that's one thought, one important element. Then, of course, per country, you do have to have some knowledge of how does the market actually look like. And it's a risk, of course, that you a lot of time will pass before you actually have a proper knowledge of that. So you have to level between deep knowledge and making progress on short term, also with the example of Theo in the back of our heads. And then another element I would say is that, especially talking about motors, the MVNE, so the verification enforcement aspect, that's also you do have to have this testing standard. That's the basis. But then the testing capacity within countries or being able to do the check testing on motors, that really depends on the national facilities available or not. And I think for that, there are some examples of how countries resolve that by initiating a national testing lab with help of partners, international partners, to bring the knowledge to the country. For instance, in Egypt, this has been done. But you can also think of sharing knowledge of the actual test results on a broader scale. This is being done within the EU itself. Depending on the type of regulation you choose for, the big burden is placed to the manufacturers themselves, and or it's brought to the actual governmental agency who really has to take care of all the registrations of the motors and products, related products. So my plea here would be that any country interested in developing MEPS really makes use of the experience available in countries having MEPS in place. Please.
Thank you. And just rounding it out with you, Rob. What are the opportunities that you see, in Canada or perhaps in other similarly situated countries?
The tools that I discussed previously will facilitate, the alignment of Canada's regulations with other jurisdictions for lighting, electronics, and appliances. But it won't really address the elephant in the room, really fossil fuel heating. Once fully implemented, these tools will significantly streamline our regulatory process, and that will in turn provide us with additional capacity to really lean in harder on space heating. We mustn't stop pushing on the electrical efficiency, as it provides the needed grid capacity to support the electrification of heating and transportation. The U.S. is cooling dominated, whereas Canada is very much still, or at least for now, heating dominated. And so natural resources has a pretty aggressive mandate to phase down the use of fossil fuels for heating. So we'll need that added bandwidth provided by those tools to really get creative to meet that mandate. We've moved ahead of the U.S. in some product categories requiring condensing combustion technologies, but again, that's sort of diminishing returns. We're still burning fossil fuels there. We've aligned the testing procedure and MEPS for heat pumps with the U.S., but with a specific Canadian deviation to require them to be tested at minus 15 degrees to ensure they're appropriate for Canada's operating conditions. We're trying to be selective in our alignment and ensuring that that we have the opportunity and the ability to make changes with regional considerations. Regulations have typically been used to remove the worst performers from the market, really affecting the manufacturers as main stakeholders. Labeling, of course, helps to inform decision-making by consumers, but how can we get creative as regulators to really nudge behavior such that perhaps the manufacturers change, not because of our sticks, but to meet market demand? So I think sort of a long answer to a short question. I think economies need to address their largest emitters for Canada, that's heating. This is really the most practical approach. And if politicians present good data to rationalize this approach, they should have some political coverage from the storm.
Thank you. And that sounds like a good way to wrap up that question, right? It's just, or maybe the two questions together, right? Is if you if you do go after the appliances that are most salient to users and that have the largest gains, then perhaps you'll avoid some of the challenges and barriers that you could face, or hopefully it will be a little easier. I'd like to now open up the questions to our audience. We already have two in the queue, but if you would like to add some of your own, please feel free to use the Q&A feature or the chat box. We're monitoring both. And the first question is about the seasonal energy performance metric for air conditioners, the importance of that. And the questioner asks, are there any climates where that is not necessary and EER will suffice, EER being the metric that's just at the max capacity, that's evaluated max capacity. So yeah, curious, you know, any panelists that have worked with air conditioners and EER versus SEER or CSPF, appreciate your thoughts. Yeah, Rob.
Yeah, just from Canada's point of view, you know, as I mentioned, we're really heating dominated. And so for air conditioning, we really just align with the US. You know, they're cooling dominated. There's great incentive for them to reduce or to improve the stringency of those MEPS. So in some respects, we defer to those warmer countries to really push the envelope as far as the technologies go, no matter what the metric. So even though air conditioning is not, people would argue that it's becoming more critical in Canada in certain areas where it's quite humid, you know, but we can probably get by without it. You know, so we're happy to kind of adopt those no matter what the metric. And so if those larger economies with the MEPS and with those products change to a seasonal metric, great. So be it. It certainly provides a more realistic understanding of the product's performance. So it just a view from the Great White North here.
Yeah, I could possibly add, although I don't know too much about this topic, that in South Africa, we've got a low penetration of air conditioners. It's growing, but as with Canada, our peak electricity demand period is during winter for 2 months. That's when we use the most electricity. Of course, it doesn't get as cold as Canada, but typically there hasn't been much air conditioning around here, and we had the old metric. But what I'm noticing now is more and more influence from international partners and donors and whatever to kind of standardize to a seasonal approach. So we are now in the process of shifting to the new metric. So I think possibly in terms of standardization, it's useful. That's what I can add. Thank you.
Just to support both what Theo and Rob have mentioned, from our side, when we talk to different regions in the context of the Latin America pathway, for instance, but the call to action in general, we do always recommend to converge into a seasonal metric. The reason being, it is more accurate. It also enables comparison across the different regions, as Theo mentioned, and across the different countries. And let's not forget, the appliance market is a global market. So as much as possible, we should also make efforts to identify common units and common metrics where we can all compare. I think that was one of the challenges, I guess, Matt Sheeran and the team from CLASP when developing this world best MEPS report, to really try to compare the status of the different country, it really becomes challenging based on the different units and the different metrics of the different countries. So we definitely definitely encourage that. And another important reason why we typically encourage a harmonized seasonal metric, be it a CR or CSPF, whatever the metric might be, is to recognize the operational efficiency of inverters in the case of split ACs, for instance. So that's something that only the seasonal metric would be able to support instead of the EER, for instance.
Thank you. Thank you so much for your thoughts. And I think, yeah, we've seen many economies that had previously used EER that are, you know, what you would call hotter or, you know, switching to CSPF or SEER. I think, yeah, my only other thing I would add in the US, both metrics are in use. There is a seasonal metric and an EER in some of the climates. So that is maybe one more reference for the questioner, as perhaps if there is a need to be able to highlight both metrics, maybe that's an option as well. Is about the panelists' view on how to best make the results of the world's best MEPS analysis a CLASP performed relevant to decision making. Is it, you know, can advocates, is it a tool government officials to refer to directly, or perhaps is it the consultants?
Well, if I may maybe start. It is a difficult question in the sense that I think as a plus, the document is gives very hands-on information on the status of MEPS worldwide for these important products. So that I think is very valuable. And of course, when you read such this condensed information, you always have questions. Well, what about this? What about that? For instance, what about the absolute numbers, savings possible? But I think as a starting point, it gives a very good overview where we stand in terms of MEPS and also the importance of the tool MEPS. I cannot fully assess whether this is sufficient, but I think it's a very good start.
Yeah, if I could add something, I think it's a very, very useful resource when needed. So when research is being done or government is thinking about putting in MEPS, it's always useful to have a comparison. I know when we do our techno-economic analyses, there's always a request for case studies, and then, you know, you want to go beyond the EU, for example, because it's not really relevant to South Africa. We've got very different GDPs, we've got different climates, we've got different densities of population and also all sorts of things. So it's nice to have access to information, and it also puts you in context on the global map. So it's really nice to have that map that you showed about the electric motors earlier. So we had a couple of the two troublesome companies that I spoke to about earlier telling us, well, these MEPS don't exist and whatever, and then you put the map up, and then quickly they have to keep quiet because what they're saying is simply not true, and you've got evidence and they're just talking from anecdotally or whatever suits them. So certainly, of course, I mean, let's be clear about it. You know, as exciting as MEPS is for all of us, most people aren't that interested in that, you know, in the mainstream. So we've got to keep that in mind. What I find is important is that the information is available when you need it. So when you need it, is it accessible? Is it available? Is it reliable? But it's certainly not going to compete with the latest iPhone model or things that attract people's mind, or you know what Tesla is doing tomorrow. We're just not going to get that kind of traction. What we need is to have it available when we need it, so that we can defend positions and make evidence-based decision-making. Thank you.
If I may add to that, and again, building upon the comments from the other panelists, I think it brings a very necessary view on MEPS when countries are looking to improve their MEPS or increase the stringency of their MEPS, revise the MEPS. What's typically done, at least based on my experience, is to, you know, make a domestic national study, and if at best, compare that to neighbors. But that exercise not necessarily includes a global vision of the best in class. And that comparison, I think, is really useful to see, okay, where's the bar? Where should we be heading at, including countries, big manufacturers such as China in this analysis is definitely very useful, because it does bring the perspective of what, you know, people that are developing and producing the products that you're going to buy, in the case that you're an important importer country, what are they actually producing in-house versus what they export? And if they export, that makes in some occasions the bulk of the global market. So I think it's a very useful piece of analysis, very useful tool. And as Theo mentioned, we don't know when would be the point in time where each of the countries would be needing this, but it's really useful that it's there. And whenever there's conversations with different governments, different countries, or even on a more regional level, this is definitely a very useful tool to present and say, well, this is where you are, but let's not only stay at what we can improve within our baseline, but really try to compare this with the global trends of what the best in class are doing. So indeed, very useful. Thank you.
Yeah, and just to follow up, I am a representative of the Government of Canada, and you know, I can say that certainly this is very useful. As I mentioned, we often work under the shadow of the U.S. and what they're doing, and so this provides a you know, great insight into the more global marketplace, where things are, best approaches, and so and some great suggestions and recommendations. Some sort of affirm that we're on the right track, and it also affirms that we've got more work to do in certain product areas. So. So thank you for this.
Thank you so much. Actually, you know, we have a question here from another attendee who asks, is there something that could be done for smaller economies? So can we actively support the benchmarking of MEPS across individual governments? May feel too. Any thoughts on that from the panel? What more could be done, you know, to get into?
I'll take a stab. Certainly. With economies, you know, with less stringent MEPS, to echo Theo's note, it's often political will. If more stringent MEPS are in place in economies that have robust regulatory processes and mature supply chains of compliant products, then I think it could or should be adopted, and it could be reasonably quickly and easily. Now, of course, an assessment would need to be done if there's regional impacts. That said, I do appreciate that I'm speaking from a pretty comfortable home in Canada, despite the uncomfortably winter weather outside, and have limited knowledge of some of the smaller economies that face these challenges. I do have a suggestion that perhaps those economies with more stringent MEPS should look outside of their borders with their analyses more globally into product design and supply chains, and even consider negotiating maybe more flexibility within their own jurisdiction to achieve greater effects across all jurisdictions, and take a bigger look at the process and what will benefit not only their own citizens, but this global effort at mitigating climate change and adapting to it.
Yeah, perhaps if I could add again from a developing world perspective, often some of these countries are not wealthy. And I think the first big step is to ban the importation of used appliances and goods. It's really, I know sometimes you can't buy an appliance. So when one is given to you for free, it seems like a good deal. But if you speak to our friends in Ghana, it's a huge problem. In South Africa, less so, because there is a manufacturing base. And many years ago, under apartheid and the closed economy, imports for used products wasn't allowed to support the economy, and that regulation has stayed, thank goodness. So we don't really get, although they're starting to creep in, and that's a good starting point for those economies, because a lot of junk, if I can put it that way, is coming in from the EU, from the Middle East and Japan, and especially vehicles. And they don't have a long life. They use a lot of electricity, and then they're just going to a dump, and the refrigerants are released in a reckless way, and those sort of things. So that would be the first starting point if those countries did that, and if the developed world banned the export of these products. They should take care of their own products and their own waste. Thank you.
If I may jump in, I very much agree with that point Theo just mentioned. In fact, electric and electronic waste is the fastest growing waste in many countries in the world. So it's definitely a very, very relevant issue. And when it comes to appliances or products like refrigerators, it is indeed more critical given the hazardous gases that come out of them if they are not, or they're mismanaged in the value chain process. And in fact, I believe we have Hubert from the government of Ghana. Given Theo, you mentioned the case of Ghana. I believe Theo is today one of the attendees in case he wants to speak up from their perspective, which indeed I think they've done great efforts from the government side in order to kind of reconduct this issue. But I agree with you, Theo. It's definitely a very important point to include within any policy advice when it comes to appliances and increasing product efficiency. In as much as we want to increase product efficiency, we need to make sure that we manage the waste national and internationally in a proper manner.
Thank you so much for mentioning e-waste, for mentioning refrigerants. I think those are all issues that we haven't really been able to get into so far, but all crucially important. We have an interesting question from one of the panelists, and this is, from one of the attendees. Maybe kind of a practical problem for the panelists here. The questioner asks, you mentioned a 279 kilowatt hour goal for refrigerators. As a reminder, this was the U4E model regulation level for our example 400 liter refrigerator freezer. But for a small economy, which currently does not have MEPS, which measures could be taken for the introduction to be less steep? So for instance, maybe the we've seen products in the market, maybe not quite at 1,000 kilowatt hours per year, but at 700, maybe more. And so the attendee asks, how do you bridge that gap between what's in the market today and this goal, which may be too ambitious? So panel, based on everything we've discussed on your experiences, what would be a good approach for this, perhaps a real country, perhaps theoretical country?
I feel like I'm doing all the talking, but but if I could just add, I don't want to hog the airwaves. I mean, I guess in some countries, I don't know what size those refrigerators are, but I think that's a huge consideration. You know, sometimes people buy the wrong size refrigerator. So right sizing, so buying a very efficient large refrigerator is not as good as buying a less efficient right-sized refrigerator. So some sensible decision-making around that, some practical rules when you go through all of those things. And I guess it is useful. And I think I saw a comment or a question around asking about annual energy consumption. Yeah, and I guess there is an opportunity to do sort of some of the nudge stuff. This refrigerator takes you to what the goal is, try to give it a bit of a different slant, because our research has shown in South Africa that often people look at the energy label, but they don't go further than, A or B. They don't look at more of the detail to do a proper comparison. If it's an A, well, that's good enough, even though A may be the MEPS with our old triple pluses and all of that sort of thing. So some practical advice, I think would be really good to push consumers in a direction that's easy to follow. Thank you.
Yeah, maybe if I may add, I'm not an expert on this, but if I look at the number of 279, if I am correct, this is used as a reference to compare the level of the different MEPS, and not so much as a target for any fridge in any country. Depending on the size, you have a different yearly energy use, even if you have a very efficient fridge. So what I'm aware of, that at least in the EU, it's also accompanied by a labeling scheme, making it easy for the consumer to assess the actual efficiency of a fridge. So, and that's the first element. And then second comes the yearly energy use. So I wouldn't take the 279 as a benchmark for all fridges.
Great, thank you. Thank you for that. Any other inputs for maybe economies getting started or who any intermediate steps? Okay, well, I'll just mention maybe one or two of the questions that have come in. One attendee asked about commercial refrigerators, freezers. Looks like, Martin, you posted a link to some of the EU work on the MEPS. Of course, that is a major category. I think, at least from our perspective, very difficult to compare across economies, as mm-hmm. there are many different product definitions. Sometimes even the size of products can't be compared across economies, because some look at the linear frontage, some look at the area. I remember us having quite a bit of trouble with that in previous work on it. But certainly that would be a good one to know about, just because it is a major energy user. So appreciate any panelists' comments on that. And the very last item would be, MEPS, expressing MEPS in terms of cost. I think Theo, you mentioned MEPS aren't as exciting as an iPhone or a Tesla, but everybody knows the prices of those. So perhaps our problem isn't the MEPS, it's the kilowatt hours and the EEIs. And if we talked in terms of money, maybe that would work better. So Appreciate any closing thoughts on those two items before we wrap up.
So I can't really speak about commercial refrigeration. So I'll leave that one. With regards how to make it more exciting, I don't know. I think the best we can do is have good MEPS that are updated regularly and make some of the decision-making for the consumer. Because when they go out into a store to buy whatever it is they're buying, it could be they could be looking at other features that are that serve their needs, you know, compartments, or if we're talking about refrigerators or water dispensers or making ice or whatever, and then suddenly they forget about kilowatt hours, and it becomes very difficult. So that's why I always believe that MEPS are there to protect consumers from their own decision making and lack of interest in it, and not everyone's interested in it. So for me, that would be the key thing to do. I think that would be more useful. Thank you.
Okay. Well, I think that will be our closing statement. Thank you so much to our wonderful panel. Really appreciate your time and insights today. And thank you to everybody who was able to attend. Hope you found this webinar useful. We're going to have one more on February 16th, tailored to Asia, East Asia time. So hope you'll be able to join us then if you weren't able to join today. And thank you again, and looking forward to increased ambition and MEPS around the world. Take care.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.